نعمة واستغفر الله من كل ذنب واسأله من كل خير وأعوذ بالله من كل شر. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. هو الله، هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو، عالم الغيب والشهادة، هو الرحمن الرحيم. هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو المالك القدوس السلام المؤمن المهيمن العزيز الجبار المتكبر. سبحان الله أما يشركون. هو الله الخالق الباري المصور، له الأسماء الحسنى، يسبح له ما في السماوات والأرض، وهو العزيز الحكيم. هو الله، هو الله غافل ذنبي وقابل توبي شديد ذي التول، لا إله إلا هو إليه المصير. الحمد لله. We start with the praises of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we thank Him. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for every ni'mah, every blessing, every favor, every grace. And we seek the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for every sin. And we say alhamdulillah, praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has guided us to this, meaning al-Islam. And had it not been for the grace and the favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then we would not have been guided. He is Allah. Besides Him, there is no God. There is no God save Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing deserves to be worshipped in truth except for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the knower of the unseen and that which is hidden. And He is the entirely merciful to all of mankind and the exclusively merciful only to the believers in the next life. He is Allah. There is no God in truth except He, the King, the Holy, the giver of every peace, the grantor of every security, the guardian of all, the mighty, the supreme, the possessor of every greatness, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And far be Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from that which they associate as partners with Him. He is Allah, the creator, the maker, the fashioner. Unto Him belongs the most beautiful names, and whatsoever is in the heavens and the earth, it glorifies Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He is the mighty, the wise. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is He who is the forgiver of sins. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He forgives the sins, jami'an, altogether. And He is the acceptor of repentance, and He is severe also in punishment. And He is the Lord of all bounty. All bounty comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there is no God except He. And unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the final return. And we also bear witness. We say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika la. Lahul mulk wa lahul hamd. Yuhyi wa yumit bi yadihi khayr. Wa huwa ala kulli shay'in qadir. We say that there is no God in truth except for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is alone without partners. And we bear witness that Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the slave of Allah, His final prophet and messenger sent to mankind up into the day of judgment. To proceed, today I wanted to mention something, and it's from Hadith Qudsi. Hadith Qudsi is these are direct sayings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that was revealed to the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. However, it's not part of the Quran, but it's direct sayings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the heart of the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it has to deal with dhulam, oppression. We see today oppression is so prevalent. It's so prevalent amongst mankind in general. And even the Muslims, they have now fallen into oppression. We oppress ourselves first. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us not to oppress ourselves. How do we oppress ourselves? We to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because this is something that ultimately will have to pay for on the day of judgment. So mankind is even oppressive to himself. But what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that he is not, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't wrong mankind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not wrong mankind in the least. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says he does not wrong mankind in the least. Rather, mankind, he wrongs his own self. So we want to relate the hadith. And it's related on the hadith of, it's related on the authority of Abu Dharr, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who was a great companion of the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. An Abi Dharr, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, an Nabiya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, fima ruwiya, عن الله تبارك وتعالى أنه قال يا عبادي إني هرمت ظلم على نفسي وجعلته بينكم محرما فلا تظلموا يا عبادي كلكم ضالا إلى من هديته فاستحدوني أحديكم يا عبادي كلكم جائع إلى من أطعمته فاستطعموني أطعمكم يا عبادي كلكم عار إلى من كسوته فاستقصوني أقصوكم يا عبادي إنكم تقطعون الليل والنهار وأن أغفر ذنوب جميعا فاستغفروني أغفر لكم يا عباد إنكم لن تبلغوا ضرا فتدروني ولن تبلغوا نفعي فتنفعوني يا عبادي لو أن أولكم وآخركم وإنسكم وجنكم كانوا على أتقى قلب رجل واحد منكم ما زاد ذلك في ملكي شيئا يا عبادي لو أن أولكم وآخركم وإنسكم وجنكم كانوا على أفجير قلبي رجل واحد ما نقص ذلك من ملكي شيئا يا عبادي لو أن أولكم وآخركم وإنسكم وجنكم قاموا في صعيد واحد فسألوني فأعطيت كل إنسان ما سألته ما نقص ذلك مما عندي إلى كما ينقص المخيات إذا أدخل البر يا عبادي إنما هي أحصيها لكم ثم أوفيكم إياه فمن وجد خيرا فليحمد الله ومن وجد غير ذلك فلا يلومن إلى نفسه. Hadith Sahih, Rawahu Muslim. It was narrated by Abu Dharr رضي الله تعالى عنه that the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Ya ibadi, O my slaves, I have made injustice, oppression, haram, forbidden for myself. So do not be unjust to each other. So if we can imagine this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Rabbul Alameen. He's the Lord of everything. Rabbus samawati wal ardh wa baynahuma. He is the Lord of the heavens and the earth and all that is between it. This is Allah, the one who created you, and he didn't have to do so. He says that he made injustice, he made oppression haram on himself. So how is it that we go oppressing the slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? You have Muslims who oppress their Muslim brother. You have sisters who oppress their Muslim sister. How do we do this and then still feel right with ourselves? How do we oppress another slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and then sleep comfortably at night? Because there's some dua that are mustajaba. And one of the dua that is mustajaba, as the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, that there's no hijab, there's no screen or no covering from the dua of the oppressed person reaching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It goes directly to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we would need to begin to be more mindful not to trample the rights of other human beings, because you have the hukukul ibad, the rights of the slaves, and you have to give each person, each thing, everything in creation has to have its rights. So we have to be mindful of this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, all of you are liable to go astray, except the one whom I guide on the right path. So always seek guidance from me. We say this more than, 20 times a day in our prayer. What are we asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Ihdina siratul mustaqim. Oh Allah, guide me upon the straight path. Because the guidance is not exclusively to ourselves. We don't own it. The guidance belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah, he guides whom he wills, and he leads astray whom he wills. So how do we have people now who go around behaving with the mind state of the Christians? They're, we're saved. We're saved. I took shahada, I embraced a certain sect, and now I'm just saved. As if you know exclusively, as if you're going to go to Jannah. When the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that even he wouldn't get into Jannah except that his Lord, sheathes him or covers him in his mercy. So how can we be so sure that today we won't be on the path and tomorrow we'll be misguided? This is why we have to always ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep us upon the sirat al-mustaqim. He says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all of you are liable to go astray except the one whom I guide aright. So always seek guidance from me and I will guide you. So we have to always ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, oh my slave, all of you are hungry except the one whom I feed. So ask me for food and I shall feed you. Oh my slave, all of you are naked except the one whom I make to wear clothes. So ask of me to make you wear, and I shall make you wear. So how is it that we think that the risk, it comes from ourselves? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Quran, that mankind, he said, mankind exceeds all boundaries. We go beyond all bounds. In what? He said, in that he looks at himself as self-sufficient. And verily to you, your Lord is the return of all. So we're not self-sufficient. All of the risk, it comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is ar-razaq. He is the one who gives without measure. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he can give you everything you need without measure. Or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He can tighten and straighten your wrist, make it tight. So this is why we have to always ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us in our sustenance, because it's not something that we do. It's not something that the job do. We get so, you know, engulfed into this dunya that we think that, you know, Boss Jones, he is the one who gives me my sustenance because he writes my check. Before you had that job, who was the one who fed you? Before you had that job, who was the one who clothed you? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, if you believe in Allah, if you have tawakkul, the trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then He will provide for you the same way that He provides for the birds. Imagine the bird goes out in the morning with nothing, and then he comes back to his nest at the end of the day with his stomach full, relying solely upon none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it is not your job. It is not your family. It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who gives the risk. So we should always ask of Him. He says, O my slave, you commit sins by day and night, and I forgive all sins. So ask forgiveness for me, and I shall forgive you your sins. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم وبعد. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says that you commit sins by day and night. By day and night, we commit sins so much that we don't even realize that we're committing a sin. How often do we have slips of the tongue? How often do we have slips of the eye? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is so just. He is so acquainted with everything that He says He even knows the slip. He even knows the treachery of the eye. Not a leaf falls from the tree, except that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is aware of it. So when we commit these sins, by day and night, are we mindful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Are we mindful that we'll have to stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and be questioned for those things that we do? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says that we commit sins by day and by night, and He forgives the sins altogether. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says that if we came all together, if we all came together and we called on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in one place, all of us called Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for our needs. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gave to everyone, then this wouldn't decrease anything what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has with Him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's the one who owns everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, huwa ghaniyun hamid. Huwa ghaniyun hamid. He is the one who is rich. He's independent. He doesn't need anything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says that rather we are in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah doesn't need anything. He is the one who feeds, but He is not fed. How can we do anything that would increase Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in anything that He has? Nothing that we can do. If we believe, it's to the benefit to our own selves. If we disbelieve, it's to the detriment of our own selves. So if we all gather together at one plane and we call on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for everything that we need, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has the capability to give it to us, and it wouldn't decrease anything that He has with Him in His kingdom. If all of us was to be as righteous as the most righteous heart of the most, you know, one man, then that wouldn't increase Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with anything that He has. It wouldn't increase Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in anything. If we were the most righteous, this all is to the benefit of our own selves. And He says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, if all of us were as evil as the most evil heart of one person, then this wouldn't harm Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the least. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is not affected by the actions of His slaves. He is not affected by the action of His slaves. Sometimes, you know, we become Muslim and we think that it's a favor to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions this in Surah Al-Hujurat. Do not think that, you know, your embracing of Islam is a favor to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rather, it's a favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to you. It's a favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to you. So if you believe or if you disbelieve, it's to the detriment of your own selves. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala still would be as He was, Rabbul Alameen. He would still be Dhul Arshil Majid, the owner of bounty. He would be the owner of the arsh. Nothing decreases from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, O my slaves, rather it is but your deeds which I will reckon for you. So Muslims, we want to be those people of khayr. We want to be the people who are always doing aminu salihat. We're racing and vying with one another in good deeds. This is the way that the companions of the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, were. They used to race with one another in good deeds. Once during the boycott of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam of Bani Hashim, when they were boycotted, and this went on for 3 years, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he used to go and give food and things like this to the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he was setting out on a road, and Umar, he saw him. He said that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he was always in the lead. He was always foremost in doing good deeds. So the companions, they used to vie with one another. He says, so let him who finds good praise Allah. And let him who finds other than that blame none but himself. At Yawm al-Qiyamah, we won't be able to blame others. When we stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we won't be able to blame fulan. Say so-and-so, he was the reason why I wasn't guided. He was the reason why I couldn't do this. That day, no. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, at Yawm al-Qiyamah, this day will be so severe, it will be so grievous, that a friend will flee from a friend, even though they're inside of each other. So can you imagine your close friend, your close companion in this life that you see every day, that you break bread with, that you pray with, at Yawm al-Qiyamah, you'll see your best friend in sight, and you won't even be thinking about him, because everything will be nafsi. You'll be thinking about those things that you did, those misdeeds that you did, that you're now accountable for to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says that a father and a mother, they will flee from their own child. A wife or a husband will flee from each other. So can you imagine this? And this is how grievous this day is. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says that the hour is tremendous. So much so that it will even cause a baby. A baby's hair will become gray. So we can't blame anyone at Yawm al-Qiyamah. We can't blame anyone. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that He created man and He guided him and He showed him the way. He showed us the way. So you can be either grateful or you can be ungrateful. But know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to call you to account for everything at Yawm al-Qiyamah. So we have to begin to become those true servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, He wasn't one who oppressed. He wasn't one who was oppressive. He gave everyone their rights. So much so that on His deathbed, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when He used to come out to advise the people, he asked them, if I owe anyone anything, then ask of me now. And one man said that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam owed him some dirhams, and he told his cousin Fadl, pay him the money. Another companion, he came and told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, you know, you once like accidentally struck my back or something like this. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's on his deathbed.
The companions, they're wondering, you really want retribution for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for something he accidentally done? You really want retribution? So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's such a man of justice that he removed, you know, the top part of his thobe, and he told the man, "Then strike me." But this companion, he kissed the blessed shoulder of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He just wanted to kiss the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's shoulder. So, but this shows that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was a man of justice and not oppression. So we have to begin to become those true slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where we put everything in its proper place, where we give everyone their rights, and we constantly have to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us, because none of us will be guided unless that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us ibad al-Rahman, those slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those righteous slaves. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to become better in our practice of Islam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us with the good of this life, the good of the hereafter, and protect us from the torment of the fire. Allahumma rabbana atina fi dunya hasna wa fil akhirati hasna wa qina adhabin nar. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun wa salamun ala al-mursaleen. والحمد لله رب العالمين إقامة الصلاة الله أكبر